With me now is the leading lawyer and barrister, Lord Sumption, who retired from the Supreme Court last year and was party to the earlier victory of Gina Miller and friends. And Lord Sumption, many people have heard your reef lectures this year, sounding the alarm bell a bit about the expansion of the judiciary into politics. So are you dismayed by this ruling yesterday?
No, I'm not. The objection to judicial interference in politics is that it undermines the democratic legitimacy of public decision-making. What the Supreme Court has done is simply to reinstate Parliament at the heart of the decision-making process, where a constitutional convention dictated that it should always have been.
So when we see in the newspapers, sorry about that, when we see in the newspapers reports this morning that the judges have taken over, that they're defying the will of the people, they're defying the will of the government, is that true?
I don't think it is. They have simply restored, on a legal basis, constitutional principles that were previously a matter of political convention. When people say they are ignoring the referendum result, it's not the job of the Supreme Court to have regard to the referendum result. It's the job of the Supreme Court to determine what our constitutional rules are. But I would say to those who say this is ignoring the 17.4 million, that our constitution is based on the proposition that 52% cannot have 100% of the spoils. They have to engage with the rest. And Parliament is the best mechanism that we have for ensuring that they do.
Would it, for example, be acceptable constitutionally if we ended up not leaving the European Union after that majority vote to leave?
Constitutionally, it would be entirely acceptable, because the referendum is not a source of law. It is not a method of keeping governments to account. The referendum is simply a snapshot of public opinion. The decisions under our system have to be made by Parliament.
Your argument, reading it, you've written an article about it, is that basically the Supreme Court had to step in,
yes,
because the government had trashed the convention.
Yes, because what has happened is the government has enormous powers under the royal prerogative. What makes those powers tolerable is that it is accountable for their use to the House of Commons. So if you prorogue Parliament, you use the royal prerogative and you dispense with all the checks and balances which make it tolerable to have such powers in ministerial hands.
And that would, and so therefore it comes down to the length of the prorogation and the intent of the prorogation.
The intent is less important than the length, because the Supreme Court have not entered into the question what the government's motives were. They've simply said that it's unlawful to do something, the effect of which, whether you intend it or not, is to stymie parliamentary accountability, unless there's a reasonable justification. What's revolutionary about the judgment is that whether there's a reasonable justification is going to be a question for the courts to decide, and it is difficult to see how that can not involve them in deciding political questions.
Is there any possible appeal to this?
What, from the decision yesterday?
Yeah.
No.
I mean, people have joked about going to the European Court of Justice. And would that be possible?
No, it's not a question of European law, nor is it a question of human rights.
And as far as the, not exactly attacks, but the menaces that have come towards the judiciary this morning, we've seen an article by Quentin Letts in the Times, the front of the Daily Mail, the Sun as well, basically saying, you know, we should look to the privileges of the justices and who they are, what their political views are. How do you react to that?
Well, I think what you've got to bear in mind, that in one sense the decision was revolutionary, and in another sense it was profoundly conservative. It was revolutionary because they had to invent a new legal principle for which there was no existing basis in the authorities. But it was conservative because essentially all they were doing was putting Parliament back where it belongs. And we are a parliamentary democracy. We are not a direct democracy.
No, I understand that, but what about the personalisation of it? I mean, are you worried by that?
No, I mean, we've had this before. It's water off a duck's back. There will be calls, no doubt, for political scrutiny of appointments. But what good would that do? There's no way in which you can find out from a potential candidate, well, so I suppose that Boris Johnson were to trample on some other constitutional convention, how would you decide that? But just try and stage manage a confirmation hearing in order to make it into a useful exercise, and you find it pretty well impossible to do.
And how do you become a Supreme Court justice? Who chooses you?
There is a non-political commission which includes a judge of the Supreme Court, it includes senior officials, and it includes other judges. Essentially, it's a wholly non-political process based on a very wide measure of consultation with people who know the candidates.
And yeah, I mean, you know your colleagues. Do you think they are all a bunch of Remainers?
I don't know what most of them think, but what I will say is that I sat on the Gina Miller number one case. I never got the slightest whiff of a suggestion that the views on Brexit of the individual justices had influenced their decision. And I've no doubt at all that the same is true of the decision that we had yesterday.
Well, thank you very much, Steve.